10 seconds of Dunkin' Donuts is more like it.
They only got half the building for some reason. I don't care, they got coffee there.
Tap now. Look at that thing. Oh my goodness. That sourdough sandwich isn't bad for a drive-thru sandwich. Let me tell you something, boys and girls.
I'm so glad I did.
It is about to happen. I even got the proper shirt on this morning. Got a whole bunch of lights to turn on, a bunch of doors to open. And we got Dunkin' Donuts to get out of the truck. Oh man, I got here a few minutes late today. A little bit of traffic. All my vehicles are piled up right here, ready to go. Yeah, it was my week last week. Still did 58 hours. I don't know how. We're not here for any of this stuff. It's just all flapping the gums. We're here for a day in the shop, making it work with Jimmy. Let's get in there and make it happen. It's gonna be busy today. I can tell you guys that right now. Stay tuned. And for anybody that might be curious, I rebuilt this yesterday. I repurposed an oil rack. They were gonna scrap it. And now it's my workbench from the metal break. Uh-oh. This is not the same one with the jump timing chain, but I suspect it may have a similar problem. Customer said they started in the driveway, it ran a minute, they smelled oil and smoke, and it shut off and won't restart. 200,716 miles. That's what it is. I'm gonna put the scanner on it. After I try to start it, see what it sounds like, we'll put the scanner on, see if it has cam timing codes like the other one. The love rating, it's a 4. They vacuum it and clean the console, it might be like a 6. I could jump it right up with about an hour's worth of work. It's got a switchblade key. I like how they always close these, even for hanging them on the key hook. They wear out. The hinges wear out in here. So you only really need to close it if you're going to put it in your pocket. At least that's how I do it. I don't know. I don't even really need to put the scanner on it, but it's really not funny. We're getting so many engines and transmissions the past few months. We got a Ford Escape out there approved for an engine. We're waiting here on the engine for the other Equinox. This one needs an engine. If you keep your car for 200,000 miles, hopefully you saved a few pennies because you haven't been making payments for a while. This car's 8 years old though. Hopefully I don't have payments still because paying for engines and car payments is really like a really, really tough spot to be in. But let's verify. Oh, 2012. They said it was a 2015. Okay. I think the customer told us that. I'm sure it's going to have cam timing codes, but we'll see and we'll come back. P0017. Crank position, exhaust cam position, not plausible. O2 sensor code, fuel trim lean. When the timing's off, you get these lean codes because it runs really bad. So probably they were running it for a few days, running really bad, and it finally just gave up. Most likely that's what happened. So I'll send Katie this report, write him an estimate, and we'll see if any more comes of this car. I'm going to go out and look under the hood at the oil, if there's going to be metal in the oil probably. And if they have any kind of warranty, they'll want to know if the oil was changed and all, but I don't see any oil change stickers of any kind. So I'll at least look at the oil on my way up front so I have an idea what to tell them when they ask. I think that's the one that gets the engine. Waiting here on the door. Oh, there it is. Classic Silverado 2003. Check AC. Been here since Thursday. I'm finally getting to it. Let's see what we got. Cycling switch, low on Freon from the compressor leaking out of the front seal. I don't know. Just going by experience. Pretty clean truck, 2003. I mean, this thing's easily a 6. It's in great shape. Upgraded to a CD player from the base radio these come with. Oh. That's what I'm saying. Don't want to hold nobody. I'm going to pull this in the shop. We'll throw the AC machine on it. 80,862 original miles. I knew it was clean. Get it in the shop without bouncing off any of these salvage cars we got out here in the grass. How the heck you put the windows down? Oh, that's right, I remember. It's got a hand crank. I learned that on my 62 C10 project truck. I'm just kidding, you guys know I'm old. Woke her up a little bit. Now all we gotta do is hook up the hoses. Have I mentioned how I find it kind of odd that the low side fitting is smaller in diameter and the high side fitting is larger in diameter? Shouldn't it be the other way around? I mean, the high side line is smaller than the low side line, but the fittings are opposite. I don't know. Just weird to me. It's always been that way, of course. 134A. Oh, it's got some Freon in it. It's around 70 degrees this morning, so it's a little low. Let's fire it up and see how it does. Now I gotta find out where it went. What it's doing right now is there's a cycling switch on the low side. So what it does is protect the compressor. If the refrigerant goes below like 22 psi, 24 psi, then the cycling switch opens the circuit to the clutch or to the relay, technically. So the relay will open the clutch and protect the compressor so it doesn't run with low Freon. Because the only way the compressor gets lubricated is by the oil that's floating in the 134A refrigerant. I call it Freon, some people get upset. But refrigerant, Freon, whatever makes you happy. So I'm gonna find out where the Freon's going, basically. It looks like there's a little bit of an odd looking wet spot at the bottom of the condenser on the right side, so we'll take a look at that. We'll throw the dye light on it. I'll see if there's dye in the service ports, and I'll know there's dye in the system if there is. And we'll see what we find. Let's do it. Definitely got dye in it. Interesting. The only thing I could see is, you look at these caps. The high side cap is wet, the low side cap is not. You see that, how it's leaving the little rings? So these are pretty bad for leaking too. The cycling switch in this is number one and two, and the compressor is number three. So, oh yeah, she's a leaking. Let's pull the Freon out of it so we don't lose it all, and I'll let them know that's the only thing I can find right now. So it needs a high side fitting, evac and recharge with dye, and somebody answered the phone, so that's good. And they were all happy up front. They said, okay, go ahead, do it. He'll have no problem with that. I said, and that's like the cheapest repair you could possibly have. So now the Freon's out of it. There's no secondary port or anything, so this definitely has to be unscrewed, and then you replace that whole aluminum fitting. I'll show you what it looks like. I take them out with pliers. Or I can get a wrench that might fit. I'm going to try a couple different wrenches just for fun. I always put a wrench on here so you don't hurt the line. I'm going to try my tie rod tool. I bet you it'll work. There you go. Perfect. I bet you they sell a special... still got a gut turn with it. I bet you they sell a special tool for it. I just don't want to buy it, especially now that these are a thing of the past. The rubber or plastic in there messes up. That's what's leaking into the cap. Let's see what we got. Got a whole kit. Hey man, we got a hot set over here, will you? Same threads. It's a little different here. There's more of a nut, but it's the same. So he wants the old one too, so he knows he's got to order these. A little bit of refrigerant oil on the O-ring. I do bump it a little bit tight too, so that it won't come loose. The O-ring seals it like a lot of things. You just don't want it to vibrate loose. Now we got to recycle it again because it won't let you have vacuum until it sees about 15 inches of vacuum. That way it knows there's no Freon, then they'll let you run a vacuum. You'll probably do 15 minutes of vacuum. I already have the new car smell going. Uh-oh, it's that time again. It's been out for like a day. I just decided it's time to fill it. I'm gonna clear out this tip too. Oh look, I can see through it now though. It's kind of strange. That's the old fashioned way. Yeah, that'll be good. Once I fill it with fluid, it's going to probably clog again.
That's all right.
Oh, look, someone left tools. I don't want to put the stuff all over the wrench. Uh-oh. This stuff's probably not good for you. To breathe it and get it all over your skin, I think it's non-chlorinated, but it smells pretty bad, and it works really well, which means it's got to be pretty aggressive. Yeah, if you spill a little bit, don't matter. You're saving a fortune, supposedly. Put one pitcher, plus a little bit. Because I always seem to have air left when the fluid's gone. So I think that's about the right ratio. Works for me. It doesn't take long to fill that little tank up, but I like to hold it just for insurance purposes. Works. Alright, I'm coming, settle down. Alright, we're going to do a 15-minute vacuum, a 10-minute leak test. We'll put about a half ounce of oil in it because it lost Freon, that means it lost a little oil. And a new truck status will have been achieved, at least 80,000 miles, pretty close. 2003. Go ahead and charge this thing up. It's going to purge, make sure there's no air, and then some Freon in. So I believe this is 32 ounces. It's hard to tell, the sticker's a little faded. I'm going to look up the spec and make sure. You want to film accurately? You can. Worst case scenario, the machine will balance when the vehicle's full. The way this machine works, not every machine, but this machine and that vehicle, it'll balance when the vehicle's full. And then if you want, if you're overfilling it, it'll say, building cylinder pressure, please wait. That's when you want to stop. But you also got to look at your pressures. You don't want to be over around 200 or so in this area. 200, 225, and around 30 to 40 on the low end. And you're probably pretty close. But I highly recommend looking up the specs, putting the exact amount it's supposed to take in it. Pressure should be adjusting a little bit. The low side will creep down as it cools the evaporator off and takes heat out of it. Then the pressure will come down on the low side a little more. We should be good to go. Oh yeah, that's nice. That is code. C-O-W-D. I'm gonna button this thing up. I'll take it for a short little drive, make sure it works good on the road and the compressor doesn't cycle off or anything weird like that. And we'll see what's next. Transit van, rear brakes. Heavy. Jack wasn't happy about it, but it did it. It's kind of sketchy doing these trucks on these racks. I think that it's a 14,000 pound rack and it struggles a little bit. So I think this truck is right at the threshold. Probably should get a bigger lift. Two of these nuts hold the cap on. Just look for the dimples in the nut. The rest of them will just spin. And they might get damaged because they're not designed to come off. Only two of them hold the cap on. The studs help too, apparently. And it's like a 29 millimeter to get them off. And then the nuts are just 21. The other side's in the sun. So I'll be doing this side start to finish, trying to let the sun get up above the edge of that truck. Not as crazy as some other wheels I've dealt with. As much as I like the beach, I don't like working on cars in it. I don't like leaving the sand and the tracks that the jacks roll in. And since the only way to get to these back lifts is down a gravel road.
Don't breathe that. More of it I blow off now, the less of it I breathe later.
Got a little extension to go over the pry bar. And I brought these just in case. Threadlock. Thank goodness. Thank goodness. Oh, I gotta get my caliper piston tool. This is the one, if you guys haven't seen my other videos, to screw one piston back, you go right hand, and the other piston is left hand. So you gotta really be careful about what you're doing. If you feel like it's not wanting to turn, it's fighting you, go the other way. There are good things about the drive-on lift when you do a brake job like this, and there are bad things about it. Sometimes the lift's in your way. But for the most part, I like it just because you don't have to lift the tires down on the ground. I can roll them over and set them on the lift. I gotta get my caliper tool, and I need one of these orange hookers. I need an orange hooker so that the caliper's not totally hanging on its own. I don't mind if the hose supports a little weight, but I don't want it completely hanging on the hose. I got my left-handed tool. This just slips over the handle here. Some people were asking how this goes on. Just slips over the handle. But this is the left-handed thread caliper. They're nice enough to put a little arrow on there for me. If you know to look for it. The right side caliper is left-hand thread, and the left side caliper is right-hand thread. It's easy to remember, right? Just look for the little arrow, that's what I do. A little squirt of magic juice. Adjust it at the boot. So the boot will slide on the piston and it won't try to damage it. The last thing you want is to damage your rubber boot. I gotta tighten this to loosen it and loosen it to tighten it. So, because lefty is tighty and righty is loosey. That makes sense. Now this isn't pulling on the hose as much as it is the e-brake cable. These little tiny handles, they leave a lot to be desired. Might have heard me mention that before. I think they do it to protect the pistons and stuff, but you just put a wrench on it anyway. Just make them longer. Come on, tool guys. These are a battle, and it is going in, but it's a slow and torturous progress. Come on. I'm gonna keep playing with this, but you get the idea. It's been a while. I don't know, 5 minutes maybe. I didn't think it'd be a good idea to record 8 minutes of piston turning in. It starts to become like grinding, cutting, and welding on my project videos, and nobody wants to see that much of it. A few seconds here and there, that's different. Every time when you turn the threads, it loosens the nut. So you gotta kind of balance between holding the caliper, turning the nut, and turning the handle, and not stressing the hose. Like I said, a little tension's not hurting anything. When I turn it, it loosens the hose, and the emergency brake cable and the orange hook are battling for supremacy on that end of the spectrum. That should do it. And I want the, there's two slots in the piston, you want them lined up perpendicular, I guess it would be, to the housing of the caliper. There's usually a pin on the pad, you know, see that little pin? So you want the caliper piston to sit on that pin. That's what makes the piston stay while the threads can extract and take up the gap. So the parking brake will work correctly. Plus it helps adjust the caliper. Let's see if the small gun will get this. Keep your face away in case the socket comes flying off the extension. Someone's done brakes on this already, that's good. Those of you who may not know, and I didn't know the first time I did one of these, someone said, hey man, that rotor fits off of there without removing the hub. So I bought the socket for nothing. But anyway, there's 6 bolts that you get from where the caliper was, from the back, 15 millimeters. You take the axle out, and you leave the hub in place. You take the 6 bolts out, and these slots in the rotors are designed to come over that hub and pull off. When I first did these, I knew the axle had to come out,
and I didn't know there was bolts back here. I thought the hub and rotor might be one piece. I didn't have the parts yet, just like now. I don't have my parts yet. I'm taking this all apart, waiting on parts. But of course, now I know there's bolts there. So you don't have to undo the bearings and the lock nut. But you do have to put an ounce or two of fluid back in the hub, in the bearing cavity, before you slide the axle in. Anyway, let's get the 15 back on and get this thing separated. I'm gonna get a drip pan and take these axle bolts out too.
That's not so bad. The problem is with the way this is designed, to get safely past the ABS ring and not do any damage, you need a deep socket. So I adapt it down to 3/8 so I can fit my gun in there. The half inch stuff's just too big. None of the half inch swivels will clear the ABS ring. So I loosen it with my snap-on breaker bar, a deep 15 gray pneumatic socket. I take it off the rest of the way with this, which is, I think these 3/8 impacts are also gray pneumatic. Yeah, GP. And the adapters are gear wrench. Of course, there's thread lock on them, so they fight you the entire way out. But once you break them loose, it'll do it. Now you change this setup. Go to the next one. Get it centered in the caliper hole. Get your rubber mat out of your face. Parts you hear?
One rotor pad.
Alright.
The other one should be coming shortly.
Alright. The sockets are offset. Some people don't know that that four-sided square is not even with the six sides. It's in a slightly different orientation on purpose. So you can turn it on a nut and turn it to get the flat in the right spot so my breaker bar will clear the lift. This is one of the problems using a drive-on lift doing this job. Like I said, some things help and some things don't. So I use my finger. I want this flat spot pointed at about a 45. I get on the socket on the bolt when I feel it at about a 45. That should work. It's not going to give me a lot of room. Yeah. Alright. We've got to go around and do all six. That's the fourth one. Four of them, we got two to go. Last one. Gotta break them loose with the breaker bar. My mid-torque won't do it, and it also won't, the big one won't fit in here. So I gotta make the mid-torque work by breaking them loose by hand. That's off. Now I should be able to spin it. I don't have the axle out yet, but we'll do that next. I kind of like having the axle in, loosen this up. It just kind of helps hold everything so this hub isn't free spinning without the axle in it. I need to have a little hammer to lug this off there. Ta-da! Doesn't take a whole lot of love. Just a couple of kisses. Now this little bit of fluid we're gonna lose, probably an ounce or so. I try to pour some in there right before putting the axle in, but you can also go to the fill plug and add a couple ounces there, and when the vehicle goes around turns, it'll put fluid back in the hood. You just don't want to send it out low on gear oil, because if the brakes have been done three times and this is done every time, the differential is gonna be low on gear oil. Grab a trusty rag, try not to make too much of a mess. Now ordinarily I'd be worried about getting gear oil on this, but this box is already open and someone's gotten to it already, so don't worry about it. Matter of fact, I'm gonna do that. I'm gonna put the axle back in. Slow down that gear oil loss. I can brake clean everything up real good now.
Once I get these bolts in that flange, we'll do that. That's not supposed to do that. Hang on, I gotta fix my brake cleaning sprayer. It's mad about something. I'm getting sprayed with brake clean over here. Oh, there we go. What the heck, someone got all over it. I guess it's brake dust and grease. Gotta do the backside. That's why I didn't want to bolt this on first. You guys smell that new truck smell yet? That's nice. It's addictive, new vehicle smell. You guys ever go down to the dealership, just sit in new cars? Ones you don't have to work on the weekends and your day off? I don't do that. I just go buy them. I used to drive old cars and fix them up and be working on the weekends and trying to keep them running. Felt like it was a non-stop thing. It wasn't really. It felt like it. Every couple of 3 months, I'd be working on either my old car or my wife's old car. I was like, I'm a mechanic. I'm not buying a new car. I can fix them. And as I've gotten older, I started to value my time off. So my wife and I both drive newer cars now. It's something I think everyone should wait till they're a little older. You know, save your money, fix your old cars up, keep them running. You get a little older, things are going a little better, then you start buying newer cars. You don't have to work on your days off, except for maybe an oil change. Not to mention the technology is improving so fast, the cars are getting so much more safe. Reliability, people complain, say new cars are too complicated, they're not reliable. But if you guys watch my videos enough, you see cars in here with 200,000 miles on them all the time. In the old days, once a car had 100,000 miles, nobody wanted it. When I was a kid, I remember my dad selling a car with 170,000 miles on it that he drove into the city and back every day. He sold it for $75. Nowadays, a car with 175,000 miles might still be 20 grand. Especially if it's an SUV or like a Suburban or something. Anyway, let's tighten these rotor bolts up, get these brakes going. Go across the other side. Just so nothing weird happens. Let's dress that caliper bracket up. We're putting Napa Fleet brakes on this. These are really, really the best pads I've used on any trucks. Very good. Never had deep laminating issues or anything, noises. Take note too, there is an inner and an outer pad. The inner has a pin for the piston, and the outer has two pins, so the piston will hit it. It won't work correctly, so you got to make sure you got them in the right place. And then it comes with coated stainless hardware. We'll take some of the hardware and make sure that it's the same. Make sure there's no odd bends and everything looks correct. Couple people commented on my to grease or not to grease video. Said the pads never rust to the hardware, to the stainless hardware, so you don't have to grease there. I'm surprised it's still a debate. I've had other people go, what's the debate? Of course you should grease both sides. And then other people go, but they don't rust on the other side, on the stainless side. But they do, because what happens, the coating wears off the pads pretty quickly. From going back and forth a few times, it's constantly vibrating and going back and forth. This wears off and becomes bare steel, and it rusts. And then even though it's stainless, it's against, it rusts and expands against the stainless. Not to mention there is rust behind the stainless that happens as well, but it rusts on both sides of the hardware. So I grease both sides. For me, the debate's over, but I know some people still like to debate about it. The manufacturer doesn't do it. The manufacturer is only worried about your warranty, getting you through a warranty. If they don't do it, it's probably because it costs less and it'll make it through warranty without it. That may not be true, but from everything I've seen over the 40 plus years I've been doing this, it is. And at the same time, if the way you're doing it's working for you, then keep doing it. And I'm not trying to force anyone to do it my way either. I'm just saying what my experience has been, and I like when everyone gives me some feedback. But on this issue, I've never seen brake pads that were lubricated stuck, ever. I've only seen them rusty and stuck from the factory when it hasn't had brakes yet. Anyway, this thing's ready to go back on. Enough yapping. Where are you at, you turkeys? I see you.
don't need adapters for these ones. It lets the bolt go in or it gets the hose again. What is fighting me? You guys know? Something's not happy about something. It's probably turning the caliper piston slightly. All right. I think we are golden, Jerry. I'm gonna help it a little bit. It's one of the things when you eyeball this. You hang out. You hang there a second. I'll be right back.
Say hello to my little friend.
Nobody messes with Tony Montana. Oh, maybe this guy does. Don't worry, we got extensions for that. All right. I could buy a few more minutes putting this wheel back on. Because, I got done too quick. The sun is not past the lift yet. Oh well. We got a hat, some long pants, sun shades, portable tents, whatever we got to use. You know, it's getting serious when my Homac cart is out here on the back pad. I'm gonna put an engine in this here 2014 Ford Escape. Now, I know it doesn't come out the top looking at it, it must come out the bottom, but the wiper cowl's got to come off either way, so it's possible. I'll look at the procedure on this thing. This is one you might remember from last week. Paul was driving by and it was smoking out of the tailpipes. It's blown up pretty good. Something going on with the turbo possibly too. So I don't know what they got for it. I think that's the engine. And obviously it doesn't come with a turbo or any of that stuff. We have to check it very carefully for contamination, damage to the turbo. Sometimes the impellers get engine parts in them and stuff. It's knocking and banging and smoking. And that's what we're doing next. You might be saying, what about a love rating? How many miles are on it? 203,000 miles, it says on the key. I don't know if that's accurate and I didn't look. The battery is stone dead. We had to jump it and drive it in on a jump box. So we took that off now. Everything's dead. The love rating on it, I mean, appearance-wise, it's probably like a 6. The interior, I mean, it smells like skunks have been having a serious battle in here, like WWE, MMA-style fighting going on. But that's not my concern. It's clean. I'm just taking care of my glaucoma while I actually drove it on the jump box. If you're gonna do an engine, you gotta take the wipers off, silly. Should be able to flex these off. If not, I have to get my wiper puller. I don't want to break the glass. Seems to be a lot of flex in the post. Hey, you know what? A couple more pushes. I see it starting to move on the post. I don't need no stinking tool. I need two hands. I think if I push this, there you go.
Yeah, it was just bound up. I'll take these keys too. What do you say?
These clips. This has been on and off here a few times, it looks like, already. Because everything's chewed up and clips are missing.
It's probably on his third engine.
I don't know. I'm just speculating. EcoBoom, 2 liters.
I heard a rumor that Ford's going to be doing away with dealerships. They're just having for service. And you'll be ordering, if you order Fords, you'll just be ordering online. I don't know. I guess they'll ship them to you or something. I don't know how that's going to work. Probably just a rumor. I don't think they'd be able to do something like that. Too many dealers would stop servicing their vehicles if they can't sell them. They make a lot more money selling them. Regardless, they tell you it's 10%. So bad. Look, you can see the battery now. I'm gonna take this air filter box out of here. Uh-oh. Oh, it's not even screwed down. I thought it was stripped. It's not screwed in. Well, that's no good. Why would they do that? Well, maybe it is stripped. Some of them were in and just spinning, and some of them weren't in at all. So it's a combination of strip plastic housing, so the housings are all broken and stuff. If screws go into plastic, you just snug it down. You don't have to crank them. Hopefully we're gonna do new air filters and stuff like that. It's only held on by the air cleaner cover. It's only held on to make sure it filters the air. Press fit, a couple vacuum lines. Boy, this is the aftermarket too. That's different. It's stripped out. See if the engineer pliers are up to the task here. This thing is, it's what you call damaged. Uh-oh. That's probably not good. Let me set you guys down someplace safe. I got some locking pliers that might work. Oh, that's terrible. These are great for messed up nuts, but that was messed up too far. No worries. I brought backup. No worries. These are brand new. You hear that? Yeah, that little strip screwed tight. I don't know what it used to look like. We're going to have to throw this one out and get a new one. Oh, my goodness. We're only 10 minutes in. Rubber deals. Pull them off of there. Everything should fit out. Hey, I can see stuff. There's a lot going on in there for a little four cylinder. My goodness. You gotta take all this battery box stuff out of there next. That's easy. Just pops right off there, no big deal. Something's going on in here. I glossed over the procedure really briefly. Oh, okay. Pull this connector out. It makes sense. Because anytime you do any repairs, you always want to disturb the fuse box. And the main connectors that run the vehicle. You always want to mess with that stuff. All those delicate little hairpins. You guys can see this little catch. You gotta pull this little catch out of your way. Dunk. And then I think you can flip this lever up. That's not so bad. What are you complaining about? Just be very careful with all those pins. At least they're not 050s. They look like they're quite a bit larger than that. They're not as fragile. Still can't really get a lot out of the way, but you can get a little out of the way. I'll lay this on here for now so water doesn't get in it while the engine's out. I'm not gonna do this engine job in a rush and try to get it done in a day or anything crazy like that. I'm too old for that stuff. I'm gonna try to get this engine job done by today. It's Monday right now, around 2:30. If I get it done about the same time Wednesday, I'll be happy. I don't ever make any money doing engines. Because I'm going to do everything in my power to make sure I don't have to do it again because of something I did wrong. Now, if we get a bad engine from the salvage place, that's different. They'll pay me for that. If I make a mistake, that's on me. So it's not worth trying to set land speed records. That is jammed on there. How's the song go? Jam on it. I'm going to replace this battery, so battery's stone dead. And I can unbolt the ground from the other side here. A cable end over here, so. And we'll just lift the battery out of there and I'll get that off on the workbench. You're just being too nice. I'm always too nice. That's gonna need to be cleaned up just a little. That's why everything jammed. You know, you guys know vinegar cleans up electrical corrosion, right? That's what I did every time I repaired a hybrid battery. All the copper and brass parts or whatever they're made out of, you put them in vinegar and it cleans everything up real good. That's what we'll probably do with this thing. A little bit of magic juice in there. Uh-oh, I'm running low. I need to get some more. One screw and one snap clip. We got solenoid on the other side of the box. I'm putting all these parts behind the car in the back, underneath it a little bit. Just kind of have them out of my way while I do everything in the front. I'm stalling a little bit. Carry on. Four medium-sized nuts. I think this bracket just covers the transmission mount. Oh, an air filter. I'm going to pick up these spark plugs. I want to at least pull these plugs out. Our security's 18-wheeler. I'm going to get a look at these plugs. Just to feel a little bit better. Hoping to find a little damage on an electrode or sparkly bits on the plugs, things like that from, you know, signs of a piston being damaged. All right, that's got metal bits on it. I don't know if you can see that. There's little aluminum flakes on it. So that's what I was hoping to see. This is what I would have done if I was asked to check it. Oh, and it's been burning oil a while. Let go of my gun. Cylinder 1 and 3, I see little metal bits. That's good. Carry on. My best bet might be to drain the coolant now. Not sure what he's doing up there. Must be surveying the area for loose bolts. Because I see a lot of them. This is supposed to have an underbelly tray all the way down. It's totally missing. Man, don't go over any crazy speed bumps. You won't have any AC. Front wheel drive only, not all wheel drive. That's good. That is oil pouring out of the exhaust. That's why it's smoking a lot. Find the radiator drain, which is right here. Decided to pull this tube out because it'd be easier to get the radiator drain open. Made quite a mess. Would have been nice if some of it went in the oil drain. Nope. All on the ground. I'll put this back here with the others. No, it's not blocking the radiator drain. I put my coolant pan in the oil drain so it doesn't splash all over trying to make it to the ground. So, I see some guys dump coolant in the oil drain. I don't know. To me, that's not the way you should do it. But, you know, whatever makes you feel good about yourself. I don't like to do that because coolant doesn't go in the oil, and chances are they make your shop pay added fees for mixing them. It's one thing to get a little bit in there. It's another thing to dump a gallon and a half of coolant in the oil. Because it's coming out one way or another. Oh, it's all water. Something's not right with this job. I don't know if it came from a used car lot or what. Straight water. A whole bunch of bolts have been messed with. You always want to be careful with your coolant drain. Make sure it all comes out into your pan. It's designed to be very efficient and not make a mess. I'd worry a lot more about it if it was actually cooling. It's water. So carry on. Keep going. I'm not worried about it. Now they got all the water out of their cooling system. Water actually cools very well. But it has no lubrication or corrosion inhibitive property. It boils easier than coolant. But water actually will cool an engine much better. When I raced, we used to use water, and we added water wetter, which gave lubrication to it. Nasty. 16 hours pays. I looked in the labor guide, it says 15.7. We got a 3/10 buffer. See more stuff. Coming right off. I got new glue. So oil dripping out of the exhaust, which kind of figured that would happen. I'm going to take all the procedure for this is you have to drop the engine, transmission, and subframe out on jack stands. They sell support fixtures and all that crazy stuff, but only the Ford dealer is going to have that stuff. So I'm just going to put it on four jack stands somehow, and then use the engine hoist to lift the engine off the transmission while it's on the jack stands. And hope everything doesn't fall over, because sometimes it does. All we can do is figure out what to do then. So I'm going to take all the bottom bolts. This will all be about 18 inches off the ground, so I don't want to deal with these bolts on the ground laying on my back, right? So I'll take all the lower bolts off, and that way I'll just be able to sit on my little creeper seat and finish the rest. And I'll probably put a fifth jack stand under the bell housing, or maybe a floor jack, so I can raise and lower the transmission to get the engine out. Now, one of the tricky things on a job like this is figuring out which wires are going to go out with the engine and which are going to stay in with the car. Now, if you follow the instructions to the letter, you'll probably be okay. Sometimes they'll miss something here and there too, so you still got to be very careful. That one's got a double entendre, or whatever that's called. This I disconnected from the fuse panel here. I'm going to do a couple heater hoses I think I have to disconnect next. The fuel lines. Oh, I had to go in the car and disconnect the steering coupler too. Show you guys what that looks like. Those goodies down there. Because when you drop that cradle, it's got the rack and pinion on it. So I just straightened, made sure everything was straight, disconnected it. And I'll do the motor mounts last once I get my jack stands wherever I'd like them. Almost forgot, I gotta take the Freon out too. Because it would be terrible to disconnect the lines and have Freon in there when you do it. Well, I hope these are 1234. I mean, 134 and not 1234. Okay, good. Whew. Recycle. Start. These heater hoses, if you could turn these little white tabs, you gotta turn them about, I don't know, 45 degrees, and then you can actually pull the hoses apart. It's gonna be hard for me to do it without my arm in your way, but see what happens this time. Pull it out of the bracket. All right, now. Ooh, they're tight. Not quite yet. All right, I need some tools. Oh my goodness. They went, oh, look at that, huh? That's easy. I guess they're trying to make them better. That's like anything, once it finds a little nest and gets all comfy, it doesn't want to go. Actually, they did work pretty well. I didn't need any tools, but it's a little hard. You younger guys probably could turn them pretty easy. Once you get them to turn, and you gotta kind of wiggle it apart, it'll work. A little bit of deep creep on there probably would have helped me out, but I didn't think of it till just now. I've never done one of these before, by the way. We're figuring it out together. If you guys have any advice while I'm doing this, let me know. Could use the help. Oh, I dropped it. That's right, it didn't go far. That wasn't even a partial gravity check. That was just a teaser. Oh, you think gravity is working? Can't be sure. I took out one less bolt. I win. Winner. There's a lot going on with this one heater hose, so I'm disconnecting it down here. I already got the clamp off. I said, you know what? If somebody's taking the engine out of their escape in their driveway, they might want to know this. My first tip is don't take the engine out of your Ford Escape in the driveway. My second tip is take this hose off there if you do. It's a water control valve. It's very complicated. It's got multiple stage coolant systems that parts of the cylinder head get coolant, parts don't at different times, and parts of the heater hoses get coolant at different times. They're running these things kind of hot trying to get the best emissions. They got a lot of stuff going on to get that accomplished. 200,000 miles, but this engine's been replaced before. I'm seeing things that there's no way it came from the factory with stuff broken and disconnected and stripped. So this is going to be the third engine in this vehicle, but 200,000 miles, what's that? An engine every 65,000 or so? That's not that bad. Freon's out. Get this stuff out of my way. I think I'm about ready to lift it up and go underneath. I'm going to have one more look around, see, and then we'll get her up in the air. 2.5 foot extension. Yeah, it could probably be a little shorter. And take the two nuts off the compressor. So I leave the hoses in the corner when I drop the engine assembly out. Also disconnected the upper radiator hose, which is kind of interesting design. It was like an afterthought. They're like, oh crap, what are we going to do with the upper radiator hose? So you see it makes it, it does a NASCAR oval. It comes out right here and the radiator hose is right there. So it comes out and makes a loop and goes right there. It's, otherwise it would only be like 5 inches long. And of course they got a quick connect on it. And the clip faces up to the hose just above it. So I kind of wriggled the clip loose and kind of tweaked it out of there. Now I'll just snap the clip back in place when I'm done. I can just pop it back together, but I'll do that when it's out of the car. Just absolutely amazed that there's no other way they could have done some of these things, but I'm no engineer. I'm not going to start engineering.
One bolt. Look at that guy. Haha. Come on, man. That's so easy. One more nut. Ta-da! Oh, my goodness gracious. That's two nuts.
Now I'm supposed to take the knuckle off the strut. Gotta take the ABS connector off so we don't snap-hooey anything. You know, we don't like snap-hooey around here. Unless it's when we pour milk into our cereal. That's the only kind of crackle and popping we like. Let me get this, I gotta get the caliper off too, because that way I don't have to open up the hydraulic system, disconnect hoses or any of that stuff. Oh, look at the water leak. What's the point of draining the radiator? As soon as you lift the car up now with the heater hoses disconnected, they're gonna leak water. I drained all that, didn't I?
These are 7 millimeters.
Wow, that one's already loose. What's the problem? Don't have to worry about it. Oh, I gotta pop this off too, because that's helping hold it. All right. Now I should be able to take it off. Oh my goodness, oh my goodness. I don't know why it doesn't want to come off. Oh, that's why. You can loosen the bolt all you want. That last little quarter of a turn, even though it's unthreaded, it's the thread still touched the hole and it won't let you pull it off. It's understandable. And that wasn't the only problem. There's something else going on. Okay, man. It's the end of the day now. I'm tired. Let's go. I'll get the big pry bar if you mess with me too much more. Things are going to get ugly. Oh, don't pull the Scotty Kilmer. Almost did. That would have been terrible. I would have had to edit it out. That is good stuff. I don't care who you are. Let me get an orange hooker-doodle. Ooh, I lost my little black cap doing that transit. Let me see if I can find it. Somewhere over here. Should be a detective. Did I find a cap to something else? Oh, you know what? There was some kind of a glue in between the cap and the tool, and the glue part's gone now that it fell off. See this one too? It has a gap in it. I feel kind of sad. You don't really need them, but I kind of like that they came with them on there. I want them. All right, stop horsing around and get this caliper hung up. I couldn't get my hanger in anywhere with the brake pads in. So I had to take the brake pads out of the way just because the hole is so tiny. It's a cute little hole. That's a 15 on the strut. So let's see if we can do that. I always spin the nut first with an impact, and then I'll start to turn the shaft. And then I'll get my gear wrench deal on reverse. And a bit driver in the Allen. Don't try to turn the Allen first. You always got to loosen the nut first, because you won't force the Allen to loosen with the jam nut locked up. I see a lot of people. Uh-oh. I hear the doors coming down. I see a lot of people strip these out because they think they can force the stud to turn. Gravity check! But you can't force the stud to turn until you break that nut loose, at least a little bit.
once you've taken that big lock that that nut has jammed on that stud in here, once you break that loose a little bit, then you can turn the stud. Some of you guys have probably heard that before if you watch my videos, but I think it's worth mentioning for someone who might be a new viewer. Getting a lot of new subscribers this month. I really appreciate that. I think they like when you go over 10,000 subscribers and then they put your videos up a little more. Oh, you know what? We passed another milestone this week. 5 million views on the channel. YouTube sent me a nice thank you. Well, they didn't say thank you. They just said, congratulations, you're awesome. Which, it's kind of the same thing. I already went around with 3/8 and loosened this one too, FYI. Because that wouldn't happen that easy otherwise. All right, guys, you heard the doors coming down. 5 million views on the channel and just over 10,000 subscribers. If you haven't yet, subscribe. You can see more automotive related videos, my project truck videos on Sundays, and occasional tool videos. I was buying a lot of tools just to make tool videos for a little while, and that got really expensive. Right now, the way I'm doing it is if I do buy some new tools, I'll save a few of them up and I'll keep them nice and new, keep them in the box until I need them. But I buy them because I think I will actually need them, not just to make videos. And that's when I'll do a tool haul, when I've acquired a few tools that you guys might be interested in. But anyway, I appreciate you guys spending your time with me today. It's been my pleasure. I hope you got something from it. Enough to torque the like button. It's right down there. I hope you do. That way I'll get to see you in the next video, because you're awesome.